Okay. Well, it's the first time I act as a super rapporteur, so I hope I have interpreted well my role. I will speak about four case studies, those of Germany, Finland, Greece, and Hungary, with a special focus on territorial strategies, local development strategy, and the complementarity with other non-leader approaches. I will speak of the achievements of these four legs in governance, competitiveness, and sustainability. I will point out the risks and challenges for the future, the key messages, and then the territorial focus and the links. I will make some remarks at the end. So the four lag cases are Oberschwaben, in Finland, the Jönsö region, in Greece, the lag of Thessaloniki, and in Hungary, the Sarret area. These are very different territories in size, population, land use, level of diversification of economic activities, institutional context, role attributed to the lag in rural development. So they are difficult to compare. However, with specific themes, as it has been used since Leader One, we can compare different contexts and then make conclusion or find patterns. I mention what has been said in the groups and in the territorial systems. So key achievements in governance. From the German lag in Oberschwaben, we have noted that the main achievement is that the lag acts as a network organization that mirrors the voice of all local actors, the participation of municipalities, good exchanges with authorities, and lender, and the fact that 50% of LAG membership is made up of women. In the case of Finland, there is an original organization in terms of governance of the local action group with a tripartite organization made of associations, local authorities, and individuals who are not represented by collective interests. This they found this extremely useful, and I think it's a very interesting achievement, because the voice of individual actors often don't have a chance to be represented in local action groups. The LAG has also acted as an agency with, I would say, the highest level of autonomy, which I have seen in different LAGs, and has addressed incoming actors to the area. So it hasn't fixed itself in the initial actors in the process. And it has also a very high degree of decision making in the first instance. That means that they decide what projects and what strategy, and then on the basis of their decision, public authority makes the checks on eligibility, which is a very strong way of interpreting the governance of the local action group. In Greece, in the Thessaloniki area, the LAG acted instead as a permanent support mechanism of rural development. There are many areas in which the LAG form acts as a sort of animation and finding projects for other programs. It's and has achieved a complete change of perspective in regional and national government of rural development programs. So this is an achievement. In Hungary, where they only have recent experience, I mean, the others have, in the case of Germany and Greece, there is neither one, two, and three experience. In the case of Finland, neither two and neither plus. And in the case of Hungary, we have only leader plus and for a very small period amount of time. So the length of the experience with the leader method is extremely different in the four areas. So the achievement in there, it's based mainly on the animation of the local territory and community building with local people and authority. What could we say of these four ways of dealing with lag governance? Is that LEADER has been a joiner in all cases of isolated actors in sparsely populated areas. I mean, there is a relationship between the low density of population and the fact that you have very small projects, because they are carried by individual or very small groups of people. And as innovator of rural development policy practices at higher local level, facilitating linkages. In general, local action groups don't deal well with the concept of competitiveness. It's an unusual concept. This is because competitiveness, as it's usually used in also in recent development rural development programs, and also in the Lisbon strategy paper, it's based on economic competitiveness, and this is how it's used. But for leader groups, competitiveness was always a territorial criteria, which did not involve only the economic dimension, but also the political, the social, the environmental, the economic. So it is difficult to find the matching between these two perspectives of competitiveness. The way they have been conceived in Germany, the initial process of project collection has been considered as a priority and acting as in networking. Instead, in Finland, it was more considered a question of quality of life, on improving opportunities, and as a result of these improvements in quality of lives and offer of jobs, then as a consequence, you would get a higher degree of competitiveness of that local territory. For Greece, it was the main objective, increasing the competitiveness in an explicit way. And for Hungary, it's the animation activities who only try to stimulate participation in order to get projects. So this is a process that will take much more time. Also, sustainability is a difficult and weak concept in local action groups. And none of the four groups addressed it as their main achievement. The probable explanation of this is that sustainability has been understood, just as I said about competitiveness, not as a separate dimension, but as a part of a territorial strategy, and in the future, and future-oriented. So, In relation to the current program, the concept of public goods applied by the second axis to environmental and sustainability issues is quite absent from local action groups' action. Risks and challenges. I would say You can see, I will not get into the differences of each of them, but in common, the four areas express the fear of losing the leader specificity, a challenge of finding the right solution and actions to rural problems. So it's one is the autonomy of the local action group that is put into question, and therefore it's a governance, I would say, risk. On the other hand, it is a challenge of understanding a wider definition of what is rural development in an area where nobody feels at ease. What are the key messages coming out from the area? Most of the key messages, but maybe it is because of the timing of this conference, deal with governance issue, the autonomy of the LAG, the bureaucratization fears, the idea that they want to maintain the niche character of leader. Few LAGs have explicitly addressed in their territorial synthesis the challenges that the future mainstreaming will pose. So there is a lot of work to do on that. Now, shifting to the second level of reading of these four experiences, the relevance of the territorial focus, I would say that the and I will not get into the individual differences, that local strategies are the most important aspect of the leader experience. I mean, you form the whole seven specificities are there in order to produce a different sort of local development strategies than what you obtain without those characteristics. So many years of this experience have created know-how capabilities about strategic thinking. Strategic thinking, nobody was talking about strategic thinking 15 years ago when leaders started, at any territorial level. Now, local development strategies may be used, and in two of the four cases have been used, as building blocks for regional and national strategies of rural development. That, I think, is a main and important achievement of the leader. In terms of link with non-leader actions, the issue of this link, which is a very sensible aspect, because in mainstreaming it is the link with non-leader actions that will be the main the main factor that is important. So it's what they mention as non-leader actions are the agency functions that in some cases the leader groups have performed. And in many leader groups, in the case of Finland and Greece particularly, have intervened in other EU initiatives, national programs and measures, and in the development of other interventions in the rural area, even without outside rural development. And for the past, not for the future, and within the context of mainstreaming. So some final remarks to end with the report. The four cases show that there are many ways of addressing the same issues in a successful way, and there is no single recipe for either for governance, for any of the dimensions that have been considered. However, considering the sentence we heard on the first day that when you have seen a rural case, you have seen one rural case, we have over 1,000 LAGs, and having such a multiplicity of individual cases creates the need to have to find patterns, to find best practices, to codify the experience somehow so it can be transferred. Without this analysis of individual cases and putting them in some classification, there is no transfer of experience that is possible, either between lags, between regions, or at transnational level. So it is an essential task to transform individual experience into something that is transferable and can be communicated to a third party. The LEADER initiative has had a multiplier effect over time. It has been an incubator of development in terms of governance, competitiveness, sustainability, and all the dimensions of development. Changing and adapting regulations, if you remember what are the instructions LEADER groups received in LEADER 1, 2, plus, and for the future, each time the LEADER group adapted to the new instructions received. And this is an incredible capacity of flexibility shown in doing different tasks related with rural development. However, what will happen with the mainstreaming and the future of the CAP and the second pillar is still an open question that few local action groups have addressed. A final comment is that rural tourism, which is the most frequently found action in LEADER, the four cases, but I know from previous experience that this is the most frequent action of links spontaneously, gives us an indication of the integration between what are now called the four axes, because it involves farmers, it involves the environment and the landscape, and it involves diversification of activities and quality of life, the image of the area, and how this is represented outside. So this, I think, is the most interesting starting point for the future of LEADER. Thank you very much.